Please wait for 1 or 2 minutes. There is some connectivity issue with our counselor. Sir, namaskar.
Namaskar.
Sir, am I audible now?
Ha, it is okay.
Let me first of all welcome all the learners, those who are present today in the online classroom. Sir, I also welcome you to this classroom. You know, I am awfully busy because so many assignments have been given to us. So I have those things. So, without wasting time, I hand over the classroom to you for further presentation. I think today is the last class of BS 122. Sir, kindly complete the block and take up the questions of the students. And all the students are requested to kindly write the questions in the chat box. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Kindly take over.
Subhaji. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is it audible?
Yes.
Is it audible?
Yes, yes. Your voice is very clear. Your voice is audible.
Thank you very much. Good morning, all of you. Hearty welcome to the session. Today is the last session, and we'll cover block 4 of BS 122. You all know that India has wedded to democracy. India has professed democracy. Democracy has become the way of life in the Indians. And for the success of a democratic country like India, education, the role of education is no less important. So education plays an important role. Plays an important role in the context of the progress of democracy. Not only elementary education is essential, but also secondary education is also important. There, because after secondary education, the students are expected to make choices of the subjects, and they can go for choosing their career. Therefore, secondary education is a critical juncture for every learner. Now the students can make selective choice of subjects. They can select subjects. So this is very important. Therefore, in this context, the role of the teacher in the secondary education is very important. And all these issues have been discussed in the block 4. And there are four units have been covered, have been touching upon the different issues. And the block is issues and concerns in secondary education. These issues may relate to concern of Ramsar Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, or what kind of quality should be ensured in providing secondary education, that is block 2. That is the question of equity and equality. And is what kind of curriculum we have to follow at the secondary level, what are the curricular issues and the quality concern also. And last one is, when we are going to transact curriculum, definitely the role of teacher is very important. The teacher has to transact the curriculum in the classroom situation. So therefore, as a professional, a teacher is expected to do this job. That means classroom transaction should be made effective by the teacher. So therefore, every teacher should feel that he or she is a professional. So what are the different professional expectations of a teacher? How can the teacher feel that he is a good professional? So therefore, for that purpose, professional development of the secondary school teacher is a must. It is mandatory. So this is discussed in the last unit of block 4. So let's come to first block 4. The unit is the title is universalization of secondary education. If you just recall the last 3 days counseling sessions, almost we have talked about, and much emphasis has been given on, the universalization of elementary education. Yesterday, some of the participants, your friend, he or she was asking about the concept of universalization of elementary education, UEE, universalization of elementary education. And what is that? It is a strategy. Universalization of elementary education is a strategy, is a program to provide elementary education to all the school going children in the age group of 6 to 14. That is mandatory, that is a constitutional provision. So therefore, elementary education is to be compulsory, universal. So for that purpose, there are different components of UE, universal provision, universal enrollment, universal retention, and universal achievement. The moment such universalization is achieved, then we have to go for universalization of secondary education. We should not be contented with the universalization of elementary education. Beyond that, after the age of 14, if the children are belonging to poor families, if the students are having some physical deformity, nowadays we do not call them disabled children. Gone are the days, the term has gone. Now they are told as differently able, not disabled. Differently able, they're able, but in a different way. Differently able. What provision can be made there for them? Can you say, no, you cannot go for, because you cannot walk, because you cannot see, you are a blind child. You will be given education. Now, because we have followed democracy, democracy gives guarantee that every child should be educated, and India as a country has to march forward to keep at par with other countries at the international level because of the effect of globalization. We are remaining in a global world. So therefore, in order to make a pace with the global world, global situation, we have to make our secondary education as universal. Now, the question is, what do we mean by universalization of primary secondary education? It means the child of appropriate age, means at the age of 15 or 16, 2 years, class 9, class 10, that must be given at no cost. That means free and compulsory education up to class 10 must be given. This is the commitment on the part of the government. So this is universalization of secondary education. If secondary education, the student of age 14, 15 or 16 is to be given freely, can we maintain quality? If we have to give qualitative, not only secondary education, but qualitative secondary education, quality, we'll discuss later on. Qualitative secondary education, good secondary education. Now, how can we do? What are the provisions we have to make? Therefore, in this context, this is the backdrop of Ramsar, Rashtriya Madhyamika Shiksha Abhiyan. Now we are making a step forward that we can provide free education to the secondary school children. Now let us come to unit 13. Education is the basic requirement for success of democracy and progress of the country. We are a democratic country. Also, side by side, we want to make progress at par with other countries. Therefore, education is important. Not only primary elementary education is sufficient, also, the moment we have achieved the target, then we can go for secondary education. It is a gradual process. Now, not only secondary, we are thinking of higher education. Already, I have told you yesterday. RUSA, Rashtriya Uchchatara Shikha Abhiyan, we are also making strategy how to give freely that college education. Anyhow, therefore, after a right to education has been accepted, you cannot say, you means the state. The state cannot say no to the children to get education. When you say, I will get education at the secondary level, we cannot say no. Yes, you have to be given. And this is the basic objective. So therefore, let us come to, already we know RT Act 2009, I will not reiterate. The basic purpose of RT 2009 was to give free and compulsory education to all the school going children, that is elementary education. Now, implication of RT Act for secondary education, it is given here. RT Act lays emphasis on compulsory education, student-centered learning, fearless learning environment. Now we call it learner friendly environment. Where the child will feel there is no fear learning. When the child feels that there is no fear in the school situation, in the school classroom environment, then learning will be joyful. And we are much talking of joyful learning. Learning can be joyful when the child's autonomy is prompted. The child is given freedom. Since free and compulsory elementary education has become a constitutional right of the children, it is absolutely essential to push the vision forward to move towards the universalization of secondary education. Secondary education becomes the means. Why do we think of secondary education? What is the importance of secondary education? It has been told. Secondary education becomes the means of social transformation in education. Social transformation is possible through secondary education. What is social transformation? Change in society, change in social structure, change in social role, change in social perspective. If you have minimum knowledge which we get from class 9, class 10, that will enable you to play your role. For example, as a mother, as a customer, as a civilian, if you are not able to exchange your ideas, if you are not aware of the situation, that is possible through secondary education. So secondary education gives you something more knowledge. It gives you more advancement to your outlook. Therefore, social transformation is possible through secondary education. Therefore, secondary education needs to be reconstructed in the context of today. So therefore, it has been told by Central Advisory Board of Education in 2005. Therefore, RTE Act emphasizes curriculum as per constitutional value. What are the constitutional values? Four basic principles like social justice, like equality, and like individual dignity should be respected. Well, these are constitutional brotherhood, like that. So when we are thinking of giving free and compulsory education to all the secondary students, then we cannot do away with the constitutional provision. That means constitutional values must be kept in mind. The RTE Act lays, RTE Act means for secondary education, the RTE Act lays emphasis on the infrastructure facilities when you are talking about that free secondary education. Now the question is, if secondary education is to be made free, all students will come, you cannot say no. So now the question is, infrastructure, do you have adequate classrooms? Do you have adequate spaces for accommodating the students for group work? So these are some of the issues related to infrastructure, building, classroom, spaces for conducting class, seminar, something like library. Making store of the learning equipment, science laboratory, ICT lab, like that. So therefore, just saying that all children of secondary school stage be given free education means you must be prepared for all these facilities. Otherwise, there will be no quality. Then, already we have talked about universalization of elementary education. That is the best for our secondary education. Already I have told you the meaning of universalization of education. Again, I am telling, what do you mean by it? Universalization of elementary education, or UEE, is an educational term or education program which refers to make education available to all children. It's class 1 to class 8. Or you can say, education without any dropout. Once you have been admitted, you will not leave the class before the completion of class 8. That is a course. Then concerns of, now this is our important point. This is important for us. Concerns of UEE for secondary education. What are the main concerns? a successfully elementary education, a successful elementary education shows the moment you are successfully completed second elementary education, then you can go for
secondary.
Then UE most talks about universal provision, universal enrollment, universal retention, and
qualitative.
Now, these four measures make many provisions for the success of UE. What are those? I will not discuss those. I will tell the point.
Sir, good morning. Sir, good morning. Sir, good morning. Sir, your voice is not audible.
Not audible.
No, sir.
Is it okay? Hello?
Yes, sir. Khetra Mohan Mishra is. Please mute your speaker. Khetra Mohan Mishra.
Khetra Mohan Mishra.
Please don't intervene in between. I request all the learners to not to intervene. That is very much audible to everyone. You know, you
okay, yourself, okay. Now, universal provision school facility. School must be open within the walking distance, means within 1 kilometer from the habitat, from the residence of the child. Enrollment, all the school is open for the children, for the students. If the student don't come, it is meaningless. Then universal retention, those who are admitted into the school, they must not leave the school. That should not be dropped, that should not be any dropout. So their retention must be there. Also quality is not, there should not be any compromise in the quality. So quality means teacher, trained teacher quality means infrastructure, adequate infrastructure quality means available water, not only water, drinking water, but water which is very, very much hygienically good. So all these are to be considered for quality. Now let us come to our point of discussion. Please make your attention to this point. Rashtriya Madhyamika Shiksha Abhiyan. Due to the impact of the programs undertaken for the universalization of elementary education, there is a rise in demand of education at the segment. Now we could know that the impact of UEE, universalization of elementary education, was very effective. And it has some positive impact on the retention or the enrollment. Now they have given impetus to the policy makers. If it is happening with the primary school, elementary school children, it will also equally happen with the secondary school children. Therefore, we must go for this. Therefore, Rashtriya Madhyamika Shiksha Abhiyan, model schools, girls hostel, ICT, inclusive education for disabled children, national means come merit scholarship, incentive for girls, all these we are talked about for the universalization of secondary education. One of the strategic programs is your function of Ramsha. Rashtriya Madhyamika Shiksha Abhiyan. Ramsha offers a strategic opportunity to improve access and equity, enhance quality, accountability, and ability to measure learning outcomes and remote standardization of curriculum and examination across the state. We have to make standardized means qualitatively acceptable everywhere. So therefore, we are accountable for all this quality. Then let us come to Ramsha. Ramsha is a central, it is at the central level. Ramsha is a centrally sponsored scheme. A scheme of Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. It came into being after Central Advisory Board of Education CAEB, the highest deliberative and advisory forum of education in the country with education ministers of all the states, in 2004 and 2005, decided to make secondary education universal. It was decided, but actually implemented in 2009. It was launched in March 2009, and the implementation of the scheme has started from 2009 and 2010. Though it was conceptualized in 2002 or 2003, but it was actually implemented in 2010. To provide, what is the purpose? To provide conditions for an efficient growth, development, and equity for all the students of class 9 and class 10. the vision for secondary education as mentioned in the framework for implementation of Ramsha is to make good quality education. We'll talk about good quality. Quality means the time being, let me tell you, quality means quality is a condition, a degree of goodness. There are certain indicators which can tell you whether your secondary education is qualitative or not. For example, well-trained teachers, this is one. Well-furnished classroom, another indicator. Like that. So objectives of Ramsha. First objective, to provide a secondary school within a reasonable distance. What is the reasonable distance? That is within 5 kilometers from the residence of the child. Just think of the provision of school for the elementary children within 1 kilometer. Education within 1 kilometer from the residence of the child and secondary school within 5 kilometers from the residence of the child. And higher secondary 7 to 10 kilometers. For secondary school 7 kilometers in higher secondary. Ensure universal access of secondary education by 2017. By 2017, it was because in 2010, the scheme of Ramsha started getting implementation. It was hoped that within 7 years, we must get universal access. That means we can provide school facilities. Universal retention. Once you have taken admission, then you will be there in the school. We call it staying. Stay in the school, not drop out. The next is providing access to secondary education with special reference to economically weaker section of the society, educationally backward, girls, disabled, SC, ST, OBC. So all these children, all these category of children should be given more emphasis. Therefore, Ramsha is a first large-scale intervention. This is a kind of intervention on the part of the government. Intervention for universalizing access to and quality of secondary education, covering the poor students, like that. Poor socio-economic and ecological variation. What is ecological variation? Those who are in tribal area, in hilly area, in remote area, where there is no communication facility, also they should be given education. We must think about them. What strategy can be done? For example, you are in Cuttack, you are in Bhubaneswar, there is no problem. But I am a student of class 9, but I am in Malkanagiri, far remote area, where there is no communication facility, no transportation. Can you say, no, mind a student, in your area there is no transportation, you will not be educated? No, you cannot say, because universal means everybody has the right to get secondary education. Therefore, we can think of. So therefore, it has been to ensure that all secondary schools have physical facilities. Minimum building, minimum rooms, minimum playground, drinking facilities, all should be. To improve access, schools should be established within 5 kilometers. To ensure no child should be deprived, no child should be no to school. To improve the quality of secondary education, resulting in enhanced intellectual, social, and cultural learning, the child should develop intellectually. Intelligence of the child should be developed. He should develop social values, proper social values. Also, he should know what are the cultural patterns of his society, what are the beliefs, what are the blind beliefs, what are the bad traditions, like that. So therefore, we can say conclude. Ramsha is a comprehensive program of the government of India to drastically change the scenario of secondary education. What is the scenario? Earlier, before the intervention of Ramsha, the situation of secondary education in India was very precarious. The situation was deplorable. Therefore, to improve the situation, for example, enrollment was not encouraging. The teachers were not adequately trained. The physical facilities of the school was not adequate. So to improve this, therefore Ramsha could do well. Ramsha can help you. Now, since Ramsha can do, but for doing all this, a lot of money is required. Also, sometimes those who are unable to come to the portal of formal education, school is a formal education, then for them an alternative scheme is suggested. And that is open and distance learning. As it happens with you, you are doing your BEd. Why? Why through ignore? Why through open learning system? You are all teachers. You are not professors. You are all teachers. You cannot leave your job. You are getting money. You are getting your salary, and it is very difficult to get second time a job. There is very good competition. Therefore, you will have your job. Also, you want to upgrade your skill. Therefore, IGNO provide those who want to upgrade their qualification, those who want to be more skillful. Alternative scheme is provided by you must have known NIOS, National Indian Open School System. IGNO, Indira Gandhi National Open University. They provide you access to education. Had there been the scheme like this in the IGNO system, you could not have done your BA because you cannot leave your school, you cannot quit your job, and you cannot join a regular BA course. So therefore, in order to meet this kind of exigencies, now the framers we are thinking of open education system. So therefore, this why it has been given, the reasons are given. It provides easy accessibility to schooling at a very low cost. It provides quality second, also quality education is given. It prepares the learner for developing skills. As you are doing teaching skill, you are developing. Sometimes there are many courses in IGNO. For example, creative writing, a course is there. Creative writing, that means you can write creatively when you have gone through that course. Guidance counseling program, for example, distance higher education, diploma in higher education, also many programs are there. Now, as a teacher, as a professional, you can upgrade your skills. You are doing your job, you are serving there, also you are improving yourself. Therefore, you can do this. So it prepares the learners for developing skills. It fulfills the constitutional obligation to provide quality second education. What is the constitutional obligation? The constitutional obligation is that every student of class 9 and 10, irrespective of their deformity, caste, color, creed, social economic background, they should be given free second education. This is the commitment on the part of the democracy country. So therefore, we have to make such arrangement for those who are not having access to formal education system. It provides flexibility to learners in terms of time, place, mode, place. Unlike a formal system where, for example, you have taken admission into a particular college, BJB college, means you read in BJB college. Now that doesn't happen in our open system. It is very flexible. As I was telling you, exam system, any system, you can appear exemption this time. There are two-term examination here in the month of June, in the month of December. Either you can appear in the month of December, June, or only one, or none in the next year. That is flexibility. Then it uses context and subject-specific pedagogy for making the learner understand the content is context-specific. For tribal people, for example, you are working in a tribal area. How can I teach the students, learners in the tribal area? Courses are there. If you are teaching the students in a particular area where there is very problem, there are problematic situation, you can go for counseling courses and you can know like that. It fulfills the social needs of the learner and design the learning activities as per social and cultural norms. Now every society has its own value system. Therefore, the social needs, the present situation requires that this, for example, the student should be up to date. Now, by using internet, by using any kind of open education system, you can get it. So this is how the role of open learning is important in the context of our universalization of secondary education. Now, another concept in relation to this secondary education's universalization is your globalization. Already I have told you, we are now in a global world. No country is self-sufficient. For example, in case of trade, in case of manpower, in case of technology, in case of human resource, For example, you can have extended human resources. You can invite some experts from America. America can take some experts from India. So therefore, you can have exchange program in education. Similarly, we can import this and export that from another country. We can bring wheat from that country and give gold to that country. So this is how a country can have more exchequer, more funds, more money. So that is what we call it bilateral relationship. Relationship between two countries or more countries. That means internalization. We must work at the international level, not at the national level. So therefore, that is global. If knowledge is fundamental to globalization, if you have to enter into the globalization, how can you enter? Knowledge will help you. So how? What kind of knowledge? Knowledge of ICT, knowledge of computer, like that. So therefore, the concept of globalization emerged in 1970. What is globalization? It is the process of international integration. India is integrating with America. America is integrating with China. China is integrating with India. India is integrating with Pakistan. So this is international integration. For what purpose? For exchange of integration arising from the interchange of world views. We can, for example, regarding corona, now different countries are exchanging their ideas. World, you know, WHO, World Health Organization. Now America, America is pressurizing who to tell something to China. So now this is the question of globalization. Interchange of global world views, products, ideas, mutual sharing, and other aspect culture. So this is a question, simply we can say, this is a question of cultural exchange at the international market. So therefore, globalization is typically understood as an economic, political, and cultural process that is reshaping the role of many states. Now, we have to exchange our economic production, or we can exchange our cultural ideas to other countries. So therefore, also globalization influences education. How? In what way? In this way, meaningful learning which shifts the focus of teaching away from a presentation, recitation mode of instruction to a teaching for conceptual understanding and problem solving. Nowadays, in my time, learning and education was mostly for memorization. Nowadays, emphasis is on understanding and problem solving. We want to develop the understanding capacity of the students and also problem solving, so that in future, when this child can become a member of the society, he will or she will not find any difficulty in solving any kind of problem. Maybe the problem may be related to life, may be related to finance, may be related to society, may be related to politics, may be related to classroom situation. Now, we want to create that proficiency, competency in the child. So therefore, now our teaching strategy is changed. There is a paradigm shift change from presentation of facts, information, to problem solving. Yesterday we were talking about constructive teaching. How do the students construct knowledge? That is more important. Then how do the students memorize the knowledge? That is not important. Memorization of knowledge is not important. Understanding of knowledge is important. Making meaning of the information is important. Therefore, constructivist approach is more important. And as a result of constructive approach, now we have 5E model of teaching. Now that 5E model is because of this constructivist approach. Then implementation of centralized scheme all over India, all over the world. Why India? All over the universe. One kind of curriculum. Then indicators and attainment of target of student achievement and curriculum planning. If we have to, if we want some kind of achievement that we expect from all the students, that is norm, then we have to make planning, curriculum planning. Then integrating assessment in teaching and process, learning standards and indicators, making sure that the teachers focus on learning achievement each board. Now, when we are teaching, we must be teaching for all students. We must be teaching all students. No doubt, the teacher makes use of some standard procedures. Most of the teachers, they make use of standard procedure or teaching method is standardized. Teaching technique is standardized. I can give an example for your understanding. How we as the teacher, even also myself, as we all teachers, we are all teachers, we make a standardization of the teaching procedure. Let me tell you, for example, you are, as a teacher of English, you are teaching the students to help them how to write an application, either to the collector or official or personal. Now you can address to the collector or to the something like to the headmaster or something like that, and you write the subject. And say, for example, you are writing to application to the headmaster. Now you write what is the cause for which you are going to take leave. Now the headmaster says, or the English teacher said, sir, to the headmaster, sir, I may kindly be given 2 days leave as I am suffering from fever. Now you have given the standard. Now this is the procedure, suffering from. If you are suffering from cold, you can say, since I am suffering from cold, I may be given leave because I cannot come to class. You are another student, he is suffering from headache. So he can say, I may be given 3 days leave as I am suffering from headache. This is the standard procedure given by the teacher to enable every learner how to write an application very effectively. Someday, one day a student has applied, and this is the application I am telling you, I am presenting before you. The application is like this. To the headmaster, sir, I may kindly be given 5 days leave, five days leave as I am suffering from my brother's marriage ceremony. The teacher had told that suffering from, you should write the cause. Now the child had written, suffering from my brother's marriage ceremony. Now the teacher couldn't understand, what is this kind of suffering? Is there any suffering like brother's marriage ceremony? Now that teacher asked the student, please come and tell me, what do you mean by suffering from brother's marriage ceremony? The student said, sir, you have told me that why are you taking the leave? You should mention the region suffering from, and the region is my elder brother is going to marry, and I will help my parents in the purchase in some work, so therefore I want leave. And the teacher said, oh, is it the region? I was thinking that your brother is going to marry, your father is not thinking of your marriage, so you are very jealous of your of the marriage. So now the question is, when you are telling that suffering from, it is applicable not everywhere. You cannot say, I may be given 5 days leave as I am suffering from my wife's delivery. Can you say like that? Suffering from my marriage. So therefore, the teacher, when the teacher is using some standard procedure, the teacher should say, this can be used in this context. This cannot be used in that context. For example, you are teaching change of voice. The bell was wrong. Rama rang the bell. The bell was wrong by Rama. But that will not be applicable to every place. Shut the door. Can you say door was shutted by me? Let the door be shut. So do those exceptions. When you are talking of structuration of teaching, you have to say this is the formula, but this formula cannot be applied everywhere. So there are some exceptional cases. So therefore, you would say. Then, if we have to talk about making the secondary education universal, and our government does not have sufficient fund, therefore PPP mode. Private, public, private partnership. Sometimes we can go for some company, we can go for some public enterprise, which can help you in the process of educating universally to all the secondary school children. The need of private public partnership is given. You can understand. That means both public, private, they were integrating with each other, and partnership starts, and they can help in the process of your education of secondary school children. So the arrangement can help you management service or professional services or support services. For example, teachers will be appointed and funds will be given by the company, something like that. Education services, for example, instead of engaging instead of opening a new school, you can accommodate the students in a private school, and the funds can be given by the teacher, by the government, sorry. So like that, infrastructure also. So therefore, another alternative for universalization of secondary education could be not only open education, but also public-private ownership, or public-private collaboration. Education is a collaboration effort. So therefore, we can think of. Also, different governments have taken different initiative steps for universalization of secondary education. I can give one or two. For example, Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan. What is the objective? To enhance access to secondary education. This scheme envisages to enhance the enrollment. All this you know. Similarly, vocational education. After plus two, you can go for that vocational education. Then setting model schools. The purpose is to provide secondary education to the needy people or also meritorious people. National means and merit scholarship NMS for meritorious students of economical weaker and but meritorious. And if they do not have money, they can. There is the possibility to drop out. They will not continue education. For them, we can give 6,000 per year. So these are the different schemes. Similarly, Udan. What is the purpose of Udan? The project aims at addressing the lower enrollment of girls in engineering colleges, professional colleges, like that. So these are the different purposes for which the different governments have started taking initiative. So let me conclude with this word that if we have to make our secondary education universal, there is the possibility that the education can be taken up by the government. But sometimes, due to some problems, the government could not do all the justice. Therefore, public-private partnership can be taken up, collaborative effort can be thought of. Also, sometimes some students could not have access to the formal system because they are serving somewhere else. For them, we can think of open education system so that the dream of universal secondary education could be possible. Now, let us come to the next unit 14, equity and equality in education. By this time, it is decided that the government has decided that the students of class 9 or 10 who are the secondary school children, they should be given free education. But in the name of free education, we cannot compromise quality. Quality means in terms of our expectation. So therefore, equity and equality, both are related. Let me take you to the picture. If you have your sim, you please see the two pictures, picture one and picture two. The picture one, here you just see, I am reading out, you can understand for your understanding because it is difficult for you to understand. You see the picture one, you will find that everybody is being given the same opportunity. What is the opportunity? Please climb. Animals cannot climb. Opportunity, those who will climb will be given admission. Only monkey can climb, not elephant, not tiger, not goat, like that. Everybody has been given the same opportunity. Those who will climb will be given admission. But think, is it fair? For example, if somebody can say, those children who can walk for 200 kilometers will be given second education, can it be possible? So, is it fair? So therefore, there is a question of fairness. opportunity should be given to all, but the principle should be fair. If it is not applicable, why should how can you think of equality? Therefore, equality exists, but do we need such equality? Well, everybody is giving same opportunity, but they cannot avail that opportunity. If I am told, please carry 200 quintal object on your head, then you will be given lectureship. Can it be possible? So therefore, can such equality solve the problem? This is about picture one. Now, the missing component is equity. Now you see the picture two, it will give a better understanding. Now, in the picture two, the C, it is equality, equity. What is equality? You just see. The level is same. The level where the three students, they are standing. These three students, they are, for example, one is tall, another is very dwarf short, another is in between. That means one is very talented, for example, rich or talented, another is average, another is poor or dull. Now, all are given equal opportunity. For dull is dull, average is average, and your talented is talented. But in case of second situation of the picture two, where the first student has not been given anything. The second from the bottom you see, the second middle student, they have been given, he has been given some opportunity, this much of growth. And the shortest height, he has been given more. That means it is fair, because what you require, what kind of opportunity you require, that is given. For example, my students, those who have four or five brothers and sisters, if you have brothers and sisters, for example, four or five, if the first child, maybe son or daughter, your brother or sister, if he or she is doing MBBS, medical science, you can say to your father, my brother is reading medical science. I will also read medical science. I should be given opportunity. Now, the father might say, all right, no problem. But your brother has taken 85% mark in close to science, but he has taken 60%. Your brother has got entrance, but he could not. How can you get? So therefore, opportunity according to your ability, that is fair. So you cannot say, he is reading mathematics, I will read mathematics. If you are capable of reading mathematics, you take it. So it is fair. Equity and equality, they are the two components in the educational success. A child can succeed in the field of education if the child is if all the children are provided the justified opportunities. Justified. You cannot say, sir, why the SC students have been given scholarship? Because now the answer is because they are poor, because they are social disadvantaged. If scholarship is not given, they cannot continue education. We want, because constitution says all should be given education, because that they want to get education because they have no money. Can you say, why has that student been given wheelchair? Because he has no leg, and everybody should get education. Therefore, we have a ramp in the school. You cannot say, no, sir. For me, there should be a ramp, there should be a wheelchair. Now the teacher will ask you, are you a physical handicapped child? So only for physically handicapped children, this is opportunity. This is the opportunity for them, not for you. So this is justified. So this is fair. So therefore, equity is fair, equality is same, irrespective of class. That has been told. The term equality refers to balance, symmetry, evenness, same in all conditions. So therefore, I can say the difference between equity and equality. Equity denotes, equity refers to fairness. Or equity is a question of process. And when that process is adopted, we can achieve the equality. What is equality? Equality is the outcome. What is the outcome? All should be educated. If all should be educated, that is the outcome, that is the target. Then what is the process? this is the process for you. If I am a dull student, more remedial classes. If you are a very good student, no remedial class. You cannot say that student has been given a remedial class, I should be giving. No, you are not a poor student, you are not a dull student. So deficiency, if deficiency is there, sufficiency must be provided. So that is equity, and we can say equity is a question of fair dealing. Equity is a question of process, a program, a provision. While equality is a question of product and outcome. I hope by this time you know the concept too. Now, in our Indian society or in every society, there is a question of inequality. For example, your color is black, my color is white. You are tall, I am short. You are intelligent, I am not intelligent. You are poor, I am rich. You are intelligent, I am not intelligent. You are creative, I am not creative. You are ambivert, I am not ambivert. In many ways, you are from remote area, I am from town area. So there are many ways through which we can see that inequality exists. And that has been given in the diagram, figure one, nature and forms of inequality. For example, inequality can be natural or man-made or human being made. Under natural, geographical, hilly area, or students in the hilly area, student in the mountain or your area where there is no school facilities, in the river areas, like that. Biological means your hereditary. For example, you are not very intelligent. Hereditary, for example. Similarly, under your human being made, religious and grouping, on the basis of religion, we are divided. You are Hindu, you are Christian, you are Muslim. That is not good. Then grouping is made on the basis of socio-economic condition, poor, rich, high status, low status. Then language and religion, you belong to your Hindi speaking area, I belong to Odia speaking area, you belong to English speaking area, like that. Or you belong to South area, you belong to North area. So there is a problem of regionalism, caste, SS, you know, general OBC, psychological. Cognitive psychological means your intelligence, creativity, all these. Personality. So therefore, because of all this, we find inequality in society. Inequality in society, social background, cultural inequity. So these are the form of inequality. Familial factor. For example, you belong to your family, is something different from my family. Now we can say broken family. What is broken family? A family which is broken means the father is a drunkard. The father is beating the mother. There is no harmonious relationship. This is broken family. Or there is divorce, broken family. There is stepmother, broken family. Example of broken family. Joint family, nuclear family. So this is how inequality is coming. Then inequity in instruction. A student is belonging to the very good school, Jilla school, or your model school. A student belonging to the rural school. In rural school, there is very less facilities. So I am suffering. So inequality. Inequity in assessment, sometimes you assess in a way that is not, there is no objective, unless the questions are objective based, it will not be there. So therefore, assessment designing is to be taken care of. Inequity in linguistic language wise. So these are the possible way through which we can find inequity in the society. Therefore, what are the, if inequality is there in the society, then what will happen? If the society is having inequality, that will lead to inequality in education. When in the field of education, there is inequality, what are the consequences? That have been discussed here. The relative consequence of inequality in India, accessibility. I cannot get the provision. I cannot get the provision to school. Because somebody said, if the teacher says, you are not a good student, why to come? Because it is far away from the residence geographically. Affordability, sometimes I want, for example, I want to go for a private school, English medium school. That is very good school, but the money, the funds, or we can say the fees to be given is very high. For example, in a DAV school or in our not central school, convent school, very high. So if you are a poor student, you are a meritorious student, but you have no one. Nowadays, the government has done 25% poor meritorious students should be allowed to take admission in English medium school. Otherwise, the recognition will be not the way. Then segregated classes, like again, the people because of the lack of awareness, the people are segregated, isolated. So they are not in the main line. Because of social classes, rich, poor, then exploitation, social or economically, so it is there. Then again, it's achievement gap. In some schools, you are doing better, the students are doing better. In some other schools, the students are not doing better. So therefore, sometimes favoritism is there. Sometimes the teacher gives good marks to some student. Sometimes the teacher physically harass. Sometimes there is the partiality. So all these relate to violence. So these are the consequences. Then constitutional provision for promoting equality. Now, one is your free and compulsory education. On the basis of the Article 21, it has been given education for minority. So these are the constitutional mandate. The constitution has stipulated that we have to do. So Article 21 talks about free and compulsory education. It says, specify that the state shall provide free and compulsory education to all the children of the age of 6 to 14. Now, this is popular known as Right to Education Act. Similarly, education for minorities, small groups, you know, like girls, like your Muslims, like your physical handicap, like that all. Language safeguards, that is Article 29 says, any section of citizen residing in the territory of India or any part thereof having a distinct language, script, culture, shall have the right to conserve them. Now we are thinking of education, for example, in a tribal area. Education should be given in tribal language, not in your Odia language. So therefore, the tribal teacher should be appointed there. And then this education for weaker sections, like SC, ST, Article 46 says something like that. Secular education, already I have told you, what is secular? We should not consider the religion of others. We must respect all religion. On the ground of religion, you cannot say, no, you will not be given admission to this institution. You cannot say. Gone are the days. Then equality of opportunity in education institution. Therefore, Article 29 talks about this, that no citizen shall be denied admission into any educational institution maintained by the state or received aid by the, if the state is giving money or grant, you cannot say no. They need instruction in mother tongue. That means mother tongue should be the medium of instruction, Article 26. So these are the different provisions that our constitution made. Article 26. Women's education, Article 15 talks about. Now, the question is for we people. If government has committed to provide universal secondary education, then what can the school do? As a teacher, what is our responsibility? What kind of curriculum we should have so that we can ensure equality or quality and equality in the field of secondary education? Now, it has been told, it is important for the teacher, school and curriculum to provide education catering the needs for ensuring quality, equality. A teacher should be able to develop in the student empathy for children from different sections of society. Now I will clarify, what is empathy? Not sympathy. Sympathy means you are showing some kind of kindness. Empathy is not like that. What is empathy? Empathy is a state of position in which you can think about the others. You take his position and you think that had I been in his position, what could I have done? So you are putting yourself in other situation. For example, you find that one student is coming late every day. Now you inquire. In the beginning you got angry. Now you inquire. Then he says, "Sir, I am poor boy. I have no food. I am coming from short distance." Now you ask yourself, "Had I been the student like that, what could I have done?" The same thing. That is empathy. That means feeling for others. You must feel for others. So that is more important on the part of teacher. If a child could not prosecute his education for the second education, you must feel for him. What can I do? What are the provisions of government? What does Ramsar say? What is the concept? How can I take the help of Ramsar? Like that. So this is what we teach. All activities of men and women, big or small, significant or insignificant, become a part of the social system. All members are equal. So therefore, the human rights, the teacher should feel that all the children are human beings. All should be respected. The teacher should not make any discrimination. No, impartial. The teacher should be impartial. So therefore, the right of equality emphasizes that everyone can claim equality despite different gender, in gender, religion, caste, color, language. So the teacher should not consider the students in this way. Role of teachers in promoting equality. Number one, classroom is the center of the educational process. We are providing education. Oh yeah, education has no life without classroom. The teacher is giving the life to the education process. And this is also the forefront of equality for student. Teachers learn to recognize the social and, that means simply you can say, the teacher should have adequate conceptual understanding of what is the concept of equality. So as a teacher, you must know it, then you can implement, otherwise not. So that you can develop a proper attitude. You shouldn't have a biased attitude because you are a responsible one. Second, teachers need to develop a classroom guideline, how to behave in the classroom situation, how to interact with the situation. Sometimes what happens, there is among the students, they get quarreled. Sometimes the students say, "Hey, oh, you are a student. Oh, I am very rich. I am very, my father is an officer." You should, in the beginning, as a teacher, you should tell, this is the guideline of the classroom. You cannot go beyond that. So therefore, dealing with friends, situation, peers, teachers, to maintain friendly atmosphere. So you must maintain friendly atmosphere. No fear. Teacher finds a few students are negatively motivated. Sometimes it is happen like that. Cheating, quarreling, abusing. So that should not be encouraged. The teacher should take care of it. So the students should be engaged in constructive work. The school management should treat all the teachers and students equal. Also, the management committee, the members of the committee, they are also held responsible. They should treat equally the teachers and students. Being a teacher, one should realize the importance of inclusive teaching. That means, let all the students be included in my teaching. My teaching is not for the good students. I will teach all physically handicapped, blind, girls, boys, talented, average, dull, all students. The teacher uses any resources in the classroom for this. So, because there are many types of students. Some are tribal, some are SC, some are OBC, some are poor, some are rich. So multicultural setting should be established in the classroom situation so that the students will find interesting. Also, a variety of activities, you are doing activities, but those activities should be based upon the different cultures, multicultural. So therefore, it should be taken care of by the teacher. In planning the lesson, the teacher need to be careful about the reflecting the diverse nature of the classroom. Already I have told you, every moment in the classroom there is change, diversity, change, flexibility. Because already I have told you, difference is a fact, let us celebrate it. Some are good students, some are SC students, some are poor students, some are dull students, some are tall students. Some are physical handicapped. A variety of students are there. therefore how to manage them, that you should take care of it, diverse nature. Again, important, teacher ensure that the students have equal access to the opportunity and participation. That means in the school situation, for example, there is a physically handicapped child. If there is no ramp, how can he will find difficulty? How can he come to the class? Therefore, you should take care of it. That means you cannot allow the child to get deprived of the different commitments of the constitution. A teacher should also be well versed with the principles of ethics and equity in the school system. That means equal in the school system. As a teacher, I am teaching. Beyond teaching, I am also a man who can understand the personal problem of the student. That is my ethics. I must be lovable. I must take care of my students. Caring attitude, that I should do. So therefore, principle of equality, all should be equally treated. Then role of curriculum in ensuring equality. Equality and diversity should be included in the curriculum rather than targeted and response to multiplicity and identity. That means equality and diversity. Sometimes we are equal, irrespective. For example, there are different kinds of students. Maybe average, maybe intelligent, maybe dull. We can have different activities. That is different. Besides that, we can say no. All are to teach. All are to learn mathematics. You cannot say I am so dull. I am physically handicapped. I will not learn mathematics. All right. You have to learn mathematics, but your method will be different. So that should be approach. Kinds of inclusiveness in the curriculum construction. How the components included in the curriculum we dealt with. What strategy? We cannot follow the same strategy. For example, the blind child cannot see. How can you teach? For him, Louis Bell. So similarly, gender issue is another important aspect. For the boys, for girls, how can you deal with it? So that gender discrimination should not be there. Then curriculum is for masses. Curriculum is for masses, not for classes, not for few, for all. Curriculum should provide diverse experiences and greatness of our culture. Always, always. Whenever we are providing the experience to the child, those experiences should not be foreign to the child. Should not be foreign, Videsh. It should be very native, indigenous. For example, in Koraput, the teacher is teaching. In Malakanagiri, the teacher is teaching. In Balesar, the teacher is teaching. In Katak, the teacher is teaching. In Bhubaneswar, the teacher is teaching. But the style of teaching is not, you are teaching mathematics, he is teaching mathematics. But you have to take into account, what is the situation in my class? If the students are very intelligent, you can speak very quickly. But if in your case the students are very dull, then real selling, repeating, writing on the blackboard, because they are very dull. If you are very speedy, they cannot understand. So real selling. Therefore, you have to decide how to explain. Curriculum should also inform the learners about rights as well as responsibility. In the curriculum, we must include, how can you tell the rights and responsibility? We have to include some topics on the issues of equality so that the students can be well versed with the concept of equality. So therefore, there is a figure, curriculum, rights, responsibility, inclusive curriculum, inclusive learning, and responding to diversity. Then, in this case, both government and non-government, non-government means NGO, they should take responsibility in this case. So on the basis of the constitutional provision, we must provide compulsory education, admission, all these are there, I have told, in order to overcome wastage stagnation in the elementary education, preschool system should be introduced, specific treatment should be given to SCST students, provision for scholarship should be there or introduced, steps have to be taken in education and training to the children. So these are the issues that we must take up for the universalization of secondary education. By government, NGOs, for example, NGOs as a non-government agency, they have taken many initiatives in different states. For example, UMID in Mumbai,
one NGO Umid, he works for on underprivileged, deprived, for them marginalized sections. They have done this. So the Premji Ajim Premji Foundation, Prathama Umid are some of the NGOs who are actively participating in the field of education. For example, NGO Umid works for the deprived, underprivileged, and marginalized sections. Similarly, Teach for India, TFI, Teach for India works with a vision that one day all children will attend excel. This is the assumption that today or tomorrow, they cannot say, today or tomorrow you work, you go on working. Today or tomorrow, excellence will be achieved. They are hopeful. So therefore, they are working for that. Similarly, make a difference, MAD. M-A-D, make a difference. So this is also an NGO. They work to educate children from poor homes, orphans, then street slum-less shelters for them. Similarly, Prathama NGO established in Mumbai. They are working for providing education to the children belonging slum area in Mumbai. In Mumbai, those slum area students, they are giving. So these are the different non-government sectors, NGOs. They are doing a lot of work for the universalization of secondary education. Let us come to the third one, Unit 15. The title is Curricular Issues. Curricular issues means issues related to teaching different subjects, mathematics, science, history in the curriculum. Curricular issues and quality concerns in secondary education. When you are teaching different curriculum, curricular issues, also you have to take note of all these. Before that, let me tell you, it is not there. As you have undergone training, you must, in your continuous and comprehensive evaluation, you must have been told, also in the NCF, there are four areas of education. It has been taught, it is not there. Please listen to me. One is curricular area, another is other curricular area, another is curricular activity, another is your socio-personal qualities. So these are the areas where we can teach as a teacher. First is your curricular area, as you are teaching mathematics subjects, mathematics, science, history, geography, English, lessons, etc. Curricular area. Other curricular area, like art, work experience, work education, all these, health education, physical education, other curricular area. Curricular activity, like debate competition, like eco club, organizing eco club, or mathematic olympiad, all these are scientific activities, literary activities. So these are curricular area, other curricular area, curricular activities. And last one is your socio-personal quality. We are teaching different subjects. For example, a student, now I will allow you to think of, a student has secured 99%. Another student who has secured 85%. Now we say, oh, he is a good student because he has secured more mark. No, that is not the case. In terms of personality, we have to see also, we have to make a judgment. The student who has secured 90%, he is very careless, he does not respect the teacher properly, he never comes sincerely, he is very unpunctual, he is not neat and clean. But on the other hand, another student who has secured 5% mark less, 85%, he is very sincere, he is very obedient, he is very punctual. Now you tell me, who is a good student, who is a comparatively a good student? That student who has secured 85%. Number is not important. Quantity is not important. Quality is important. What is quality? Sincerity, punctuality, truthfulness, honesty. But that boy, nowadays, you must be coming across the news in the paper. For a long time, in the ATM robbery, who were involved? Very interesting, very sad. I am very surprised. Most of the engineering students, they were involved in ATM robbery. And we say, he is an engineer student, very good student. He has secured good mark. Is it a question of good student? What kind of education we have given? As teachers, have we told the student that when you will be continuing in engineering, you should go for robbery? You should be a doctor? So therefore, when you are declaring a student good or bad, not in terms of your product, numerical product number, therefore in your national curriculum framework 2005, NCERT 2005, process is also important, not product. How much mark is not important. This is important, but process. What a mental process. How do the child think about the situation? How does he perceive the society? Now, you must have seen, the building is constructed, after 2 days, 3 days, it is collapsing. The bridge is has been constructed, after 1 month, it is defunctional. What kind of national you are? What kind of national you are? You are an engineer, you are an Indian. What? And you say nationalism, patriotism. Where is patriotism? What does education say? Education doesn't mean amounting. I have the amount of 95.9%. My GP is cumulative grade is 9.5. That is immaterial if you are doing all the nonsense. So therefore, our education should be considered in totality. So therefore, here in the curriculum, it has been taken care of. What are the subjects to be included? It has been told. Now let us come to the concern of NCERT secondary. One is perspectives of education. Under perspective education, to strengthen a national system. Perspective means we expect this kind of attitude should be there in the student when they get education. To strengthen a national system of education, not regional system, national, all over India, irrespective of different caste, color, creed, pluralistic society, we should have a common school system or national system of education. To integrate examination into classroom learning and also to make it more informal. You know or do not know, I do not know. Nowadays, in my time, even also in your time, examination was just like a matter of whitewashing. Once in a year, we are giving color to our building. In my time, examination was like that. After, at the end of the session, we had our annual examination. And if you have done well, you are a good student. Today, it is not like that. Only written examination, paper, pencil test. Nowadays, because of the introduction of continuous and comprehensive evaluation, because of the adoption of constructivism, our evaluation is very open, very based on flexibility. For example, I will give one instance, portfolio evaluation, portfolio. Every day, the teacher while teaching must observe what does the child do today, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, the same child. Now you should mention, today the child was not attentive in the class, but he was very punctual. Tomorrow, the same child. Today he was very sincere, punctual, but he has spoken lie. So that means every day, this is the episode for the child. Now at the end of the year, you can say, these are the personal qualities of the child, social personal quality. Because as a person, you are expected to have some quality so that you can enter into society. You have secured 95%, but you are not able to handle your friends. You are not able to become cooperative. You do not have fellow feeling attitude. What is the meaning of education? Therefore, it should be taken care of. So, learning should be flexible. Reducing the curriculum load based on insight provided in learning without burden. Now, Jaspal committee told learning without burden. Why? We want learning should be joyful. When the students are given much homework, the students are engaged in doing homework. There is no time left to think about the situations of society. So therefore, the students are grammars, only memorizing. So therefore, it is not good. Then, to practice curriculum based on answer value system, national value system or democratic value system, to answer quality education for all levels, not only secondary, elementary, quality teachers. If you want quality education, quality teachers, quality building, quality food, meet them like that, all that we'll discuss. To ensure that irrespective of caste, creed, religion and sex, all are provided with standard curriculum. In my time, also you must have known, in my time, girl students were given home science instead of mathematics. Why? It was thought that girls are less intelligent. So therefore, since the subject mathematics requires more intelligence, so girls were given option. Those who are not interested in mathematics, they can take home science or domestic science. Nowadays, all are equal, whether boy or girls. All are intelligent. We will not make discrimination. So, standard curriculum, whether you are a boy, whether you are a girl, whether you are tall, whether you are short, whether you are intelligent, whether you are not intelligent, that is not minimum. We call it core curriculum. Minimum facility should be given. In curricular areas, what are the subject to be included? You know all the language subject. Language, skills of language skill, and discussion, all these are there, language, then mathematics, science, social science, school and classroom environment, physical environment, like that, systemic reforms, if you want to have quality, then system, enhancing participant, student, local, ability to multiple, all these are there for this purpose. Then developing, this is more important for you, try to understand. Developing metacognitive and creative potential. Already I have told you, creativity, all children are more or less able. This is our assumption. All children are more or less able. You cannot say you are more able, you are no able. No, I may not be more able, but I have some ability. So therefore, similarly, we cannot say you are all creative, I am no creative. Or that all and non-principle is not holding here. You are more creative, I may be less creative. I may not be creative like you, but I am not. You cannot say I am not creative. So therefore, all are creative, all are intelligent, all are able, all are interested. But question is more or less. That you should keep in mind. Therefore, one of the experts in the field of creativity, what is creativity? To create something new. For example, you are combining old and new and making another new. For nowadays, it is going on. For example, Virat Kohli, Virat and Anushka, before their marriage, so they combined the media people, they combined and name it Virushka. Virata plus Anushka, and it becomes Virushka. A new combination, creative act. Similarly, we have the flight. We call it Indigo. India plus Go, Indigo. So this kind of combination is a creative act. So therefore, the children should be given opportunity to create something new. Either new poem, either new story, either new mathematical formula, either new scientific invention, anything. It depends upon his aptitude. So therefore, what is development of metacognitive? Meta means beyond. Beyond cognitive, cognition means, already I have told you, three domains, cognitive, affective, psychomotor. Cognitive means knowing, knowledge. The student should go beyond the knowledge. For example, already I have told you, the mother, Srima, she says that every child should be allowed to go out of the world and find the experience with the world. For example, the word is ma, mother, ma. Ma doesn't mean ma plus a ma. Well, we are very much interested, right, ma? Sir, ma plus a ma, more akarma. We are very happy as a teacher. No, you go beyond. This is cognitive. mom, I have a mother, like that. Now, you can ask the child, all right, make a sentence by using the word mother. I have a my mother. Somebody can say, I have a sweet mother. I love my sweet mother. This is all about cognitive, metacognitive. Never ever such sweet mother I have seen in my life, which can be unmatched, unparallel in the world. This is beyond cognitive. So therefore, the teacher should take the student to that situation. Not the teacher. We have two thinking capacity. One is your cognitive, divergent thinking, another is your convergent thinking. We are teaching. Depends on, for example, mathematics is taught to develop thinking. English is taught for thinking, developing thinking. So, but thinking is of two types. One is your convergent thinking, another is your divergent thinking. What is convergent thinking? The students are allowed to think the best answer. Yesterday I was telling. For example, 5 into 5, the best answer is 25. This is what intelligent student can say. If you are creative, you can say, sir, 5 into 5 is equal to 26 minus 1 plus 0. What is the result? 25. Sir, 5 into 5 is equal to 5 into 5 into 1 minus 1 plus 1. So this is creative. That means you are approaching from different ways. So therefore, going beyond, in this context, 3 schools of psychology needs to be mentioned. One is your behavioristic psychology, another cognitive psychology, another constructivist psychology or constructivism. Behaviorism, cognitivism, and constructivism. I will give one or two sentences for your understanding. What is behaviorism? What does behaviorism say? The behavior is originated by making a bond. What is behavior? Behavior is any action. Watson was the father of behaviorism. Watson says behavior is any action which can be seen and observed very objectively. Maybe covert behavior, maybe overt behavior. Now, for example, you are smiling. We can see that you are smiling. This is overt behavior. But you are thinking. That is inside. What you are thinking, we do not know. But you are thinking. That is overt behavior, overt, enveloped. So therefore, the students should be allowed to learn when the teacher is connecting or making a bond. Bond between stimulus and response. Stimulus and response. For example, as a teacher, I find that a particular student is not attentive in my class. Then I can say, my dear student, those who will be attentive in my class, they will be given 1 piece of chocolate. Now you will find that giving a piece of chocolate to those who are attentive, that is incentive. That is reinforcement, strengthening behavior. A small child, even myself, when we are small children in the village, to attend the class one, beginning, we are not interested to go to the class. The parents are telling, if you go to class, I will give you this. If you get faster, we will give a bike. We can purchase a bicycle for you. Motivating, reinforcing. So therefore, the strengthening of the bond between stimulus and response. When you are calling the roll number one, if the roll number one is there, he can say, yes, sir. If not there, no response. Stimulus, calling roll, response, yes, sir. Similarly, you are teaching, the students are receiving, the students are answering. So that can be possible, that behavior is possible when a proper connection is made. When? How can you make a proper connection? What the learner knows, that should be capitalized, that should be used. What the learner is going to know. That means the present knowledge to be learned should be interconnected with what the learner has known, prior experience. So present experience and prior experience, previous experience, they must be merged. This is what your behaviorist said. Then learning will be effective. Another is your cognitive. Cognition means knowledge, learning. If the mind is made to learn, it is happen, learning is happening when you are thinking, where you are thinking in the mind. So therefore, the student should be allowed to memorize the text by creating a situation. How can the student learn effectively? For example, one of the situation I can tell you, Gestalt view. Gestalt means whole. When the teacher is putting the whole thing first, then proceeding to specific, then it will facilitate learning. What your Asubel said, advanced organizer. You must have experience. Before my teaching, I just use 2 minutes, 3 minutes. I just briefly summarize something about the unit. That means you can have insight into the. You cannot have detailed study, but you can just understand. Oh, the teacher is going to talk about something related to this. That is insight. That means if the teacher is developing, taking care of that insight, if the students are allowed to become very insightful, then learning will be meaningful. Another is constructive teaching. That means constructive teaching is based upon flexibility approach. Students can construct knowledge as per their capacity. For example, you have been told that mango, make a sentence. You are making a sentence, I am making a sentence, everybody is making sentence, but the sentence are not same. The knowledge is knowledge of constructing sentence of on the basis of mango is different. That knowledge construction is based upon my experience. For example, my father is a pigeon. We have mango trees. So now I can say with a sentence like mango, we have mango trees in our village or in my room, in my home. Another student who has not any experience of rural area, he has not seen any kind of mango tree, but he has purchased. Now he can say, I have purchased mango from the market. So you are making sentence by using mango. I am making sentence by using mango. But that sentence construction is based upon, knowledge construction is based upon my previous experience. Therefore, the teacher should go in the, when you are transacting curriculum, you should go beyond that metacognition. Then addressing the specific curricular issues in curriculum, there are different specific issues that, for example, how to, sometimes this teacher, it is written here, subject-centered traditional approach of organic curriculum was mostly based upon subject center. Nowadays, subject is not center. Students are the center. Activity is the best. So therefore, the teacher should go beyond that. Another component, we are thinking of universalized education. What for? Through that, we must bring peaceful coexistence, peaceful living. So therefore, inculcation of values in the curriculum of the secondary education, we must have some provisions of inculcation of values. For example, you are teaching any subject you like, doesn't matter. For example, you are teaching mathematics. We can say multiplication. You are teaching multiplication as a teacher of mathematics or arithmetic. Now you are talking like this. Every day you are speaking 5 lies. In a week, how many lies you can speak? So that the child can say, sir, every day I am speaking 5 lies. Week is a 7 day, 5 into 7, 35. So now the child will answer, sir, in a week I will speak 35 lies, mitcha. Now somebody will ask you, Mr. Teacher, what are you doing? No, sir, I am enabling the student to have competence of multiplying. Now the student will not have multiplication. The student will get more interest in speaking lies. Sir, why 35? I can speak 100 lies, 100 lies. That means you are teaching mathematics, multiplication, but it should be valuable. Valuable. No, there is sound. So therefore, your approach should be different. What can you do? Why not you do like this positively, constructively? If every day you are saving 5 rupees, you are saving 5 rupees, in a week, how much money will be saved? Now the child will say, sir, 5 into 7, 35 rupees. Now you are teaching multiplication, also good quality, saving quality. This is very good. So therefore, that should be there. Where can education must be? Life skill, because education is for life. If you are not skillful in adjusting to the life situation, you are not able to make decision. For example, when there is a question of please stop, no talk, please. Who is talking? So therefore, when there is a question of making choice, if you ask the parents, my father, what choice I should do? No, you are independent. So secondary education should enable the students to make proper choice. This is a skill. Similar problem solving, empathy, communication with others, interpersonal relationship, how to make relationship, all these are there. Art, craft, education, health, physical hygiene, environmental. Nowadays, you must be experiencing how environment is getting deployed, deteriorated. So therefore, there is environmental pollution. So we must take care of it. Otherwise, time will come, we will be very suffocated in the situation. Therefore, we have to give secondary education freely. Now the question is, as a corollary, what kind of secondary education to be given? If it is given freely, does it mean that it is free education? Any kind of education, secondary education? No. Quality must be maintained. Quality must be maintained. Now, what is quality? Quality is a degree of goodness. Quality is a degree of worth. For example, when you are going to purchase a piece of cotton for your dress, you say to the shopkeeper, you give quality dress. Now that shopkeeper will tell, no, it will be costly. You say, no, doesn't matter, but I want quality. Means good quality, good. So the indicator of quality is what is the degree of goodness or what is the degree of worthiness. So therefore, that goodness should be there in secondary education. Now question is, what are the quality indicators so that our secondary education will be good? It has been given under broad two. Under broad quality indicators, specific. Broad means this is the most one. Curriculum, teacher pedagogy, school management, continuous comprehensive evaluation. For example, let us take the case of curriculum. Curriculum should be learner friendly. For example, you are teaching the students, and the students say, sir, what are you teaching? You are very speedy, we couldn't understand. And you say, you understand, do not understand, I have to complete my course. No, that is not learner friendly. Let the learner be feel like friend, and they can understand, enjoy, because learning should be joyful. Empower the social context. The context from which every child has a family. Maybe poor family, maybe rich family. So you must take into account. There are many, similarly, teacher and pedagogy. The teacher has to develop himself or herself. So therefore, he should undergo training. He should attend minimum training program. Maintaining regularity, he should be regular, punctual. You all know, because we are all teachers. School management, sometimes, this is a problem for we people. Sometimes the school management, members of the school management, they interfere. No, that is not the case. If the management is interfering, then it will hamper the quality. So therefore, these issues should be brought to the limelight to the eye of the administrators. Then under specific quality, infrastructure and other resources. If you think of a quality secondary education, it cannot happen with the rooms. If your school doesn't have science laboratory, if your school doesn't have adequate space, that will not happen. So that is there. Teaching learning process, that means you should have ICT room, you should have science laboratory, all the learning, curriculum transaction, that means proper methods should be adopted by the teacher. That should be space, adequate space for group work, seminar, etc. must be there, reading room must be there. Learner's progress, that means we must see what are the difficulties of the learner, what are the problems. Teacher's professional development, that we'll discuss later on in the last one. That means professionally, because teaching is a profession, noble profession, not profession. Teaching is a noble profession. If the teacher is not professionally competent, for example, you are a teacher, I am a teacher, and if I do not like my profession, I am a teacher, then nothing will happen. So first, as a professional, you love your profession. Yes, I am proud of being a teacher. that gives you much enthusiasm. Then you can do. That will motivate you. If you feel there is no money, there is no promotion, then why did you come here? Therefore, we must first we have to begin with, yes, I am a teacher. Therefore, in your national policy on education, it has been well told. No one can rise above the teacher. Any problem in the society, that can be solved by we teacher. Even the politician, they take your approach. Therefore, I must feel proud of being a teacher. That gives a sense of satisfaction. Okay, therefore, strategy for if quality is to be taken care of, it to be considered, then what are the things to be done? It is there is a need for involvement of all stakeholders. NCERT, SERT, all these parents, teachers, and district administration, DIT, something like that, all should be involved. The school activities or classroom teaching, all other functioning should be proceeded as per the annual plan. So you have to make a plan so that it will give direction. Then changes and sometimes there are many changes in the field of education. You must know it. Appropriate strategy must be adopted. Pedagogic strategy must be, pedagogy means teaching learning material, method. All should be taken care of. So with this, I can say the third unit is completed. We have discussed about the qualitative secondary education, because secondary education is a must for everybody. Now, we are talking about professional development. Just 5 minutes back, every teacher should be professionally competent, because teaching is a noble profession. If you are not professionally competent, nothing will happen. At the grassroots level, you might have been told much by your BO, by your DO, something like that, by your higher authority. But something concrete will happen unless we the people, we are the real implementer at the grassroots level. We are doing everything for whom? For the learners. So ultimately, it is filter to you that ultimately goes to the children, students. Therefore, teacher is one of the fundamental human resource, most important vital one. So therefore, much has been expected from the teacher. The teacher should do like this, a teacher should expect to continuously improve. Every teacher wants that unless I improve. For example, in my time, there in mathematics, there was no basic mathematics concept. Now, the same mathematics man, the same student has become the teacher to teach mathematics. And when in the curriculum, in the mathematics, basic mathematics came, can the teacher who are teaching mathematics can say, no, in my time, basic mathematics was not, I cannot teach? No, you have to teach. Therefore, you can go for orientation, you can go for refresh course, or you can make a chit chat, you can have a discussion with the mathematics professor or mathematics expert, and you can up to date yourself. Therefore, a teacher should aspire to be a good human being first. Already I have told you, Swami Sivananda says, to be on, be good and do good. So therefore, every teacher should feel that I am a human being, good human being. As a human being, I should salute my other human being. My student is a human being. My student is a human being. A human being, another human being, should be treated properly. So therefore, I should take care of my children. Similarly, teachers must embrace the ideas. So you must know something about your students. How are the students? What is his family background? So knowledge of students. The teacher should be honest, responsible, physically, mentally strong, mastery over the topic, mastery over the content, effective communication skill. You must communicate. Communicative effectively means what you want to communicate, it should be communicated. That is effective communication. All these, you know, for doing all these, you should be professionally competent. So, professional development is the enrichment training provided to the teachers over a period of time. For example, you have done your CT from a DLD, from diet or from city schools. Now, for the last 10 years, now within 10 years, many things have happened. For example, 5E model. For example, new continuous comprehensive evaluation, it was not earlier. So therefore, you should update yourself by going training. Now here, different programs of professional development have been talked about in short training. For example, the main objectives of initial professional preparation. Initial, when you are going to become a teacher, a professional, what you should have to acquire knowledge, understanding about your profession or initial planning, to apply knowledge and understand to new unfamiliar situation, to develop proper interest attitude, to develop ability for effective classroom management, how to manage your students when the students are very rowdy, when the students are very chaos in chaotic situation, how to manage, you must be very tactful. To develop ability for effective class, to acquaint with different approaches teaching, different approach changing. So for all we purpose, pre-service, either in-service or pre-service. It has been talked about. What is in-service? When you are in the service, for example, now you are all in the service. You are going for training to up-to-date your knowledge. That is in-service. Because for the last 10 years, much has been changed. You should know it. So therefore, in service. What is pre-service? Before coming to the service. Pre-service. That means you have undergone training. Now you're because of RT Act. Because of RT Act, because of the introduction of RT Act, every teacher should be trained either at the elementary or secondary. Therefore, through DPP mode, those who are untrained at the elementary level, they have been trained through the distance mode. I was also in charge. Anyhow. So therefore, that is in service, pre-service, before making entry into the service, you must have undergone two years training. That will help you how to manage your situation. So both pre-service and in-service training are essential. Now, what is the present scenario of such in-service teacher education program? For example, already I have told you two kinds of training we are giving, either theme-based training or content enrichment to improve your content in the subject you are teaching. If you are teaching mathematics, you will come for training. And such training for you people, for your elementary school teacher, either your BO is organizing or DIET is organizing, or sometimes some other organizations are organizing, and you are attending the programs and you are updating your. Similarly, for the secondary school teachers, either CTE, College of Teacher Education, or B.Ed. Colleges, CTE, or IAS, Institute of Advanced Study in Education, they are organizing, they are updating. This is content enrichment. Another theme-based, new themes are coming. For example, context-based learning, social-based learning, multilingual learning, continuous comprehensive evaluation, value-based education, attitudinal change. These are new themes. So these themes should be known to the teacher. So therefore, the teacher should be given training on the new topics, new themes, which have come, so that you can feel updated. Now the question is, sometimes these are to be, the people are to be trained. What is scenario? Sometimes the training is given, the teachers are not attending and loitering here and they are going for their increment, something like that. Sometimes the program given, they are not effective. The participant, the participant says, sir, that resource person was not good and the training was not effective. And there is no follow-up, there is no mechanism whether the training program is effective or ineffective. If effective, how the teachers are using, whether being trained, are you using the classroom situation or not? It should be monitored. Supervisor should be appointed. Sometimes funds are not available, sometimes overlapping. Sometimes at a time you have been invited to attend three training programs, two training programs. Where to go? Such overlapping should not be there. Another most important issue is administrative lethargy. You are headmaster. If you are not a headmaster, your BO or your DO, they did not relieve you. No, don't go for a training. You need not to be updated. Better you complete the course. Also, the teachers are most engaged in non-academic course. Therefore, these are the issues which must be taken care of if we are sincerely interested for qualitative secondary education. If it is tackled, then our dream can be materialized and we can achieve 100% success in the dream. Thank you very much for present hearing these four blocks as for the units in the last block. Thank you very much. Now we can go for our question answer session.
एज ए टीचर की गला रजत एज ए टीचर व्हाट आर द सजेशन डू यू वांट टू पुट फोर्थ फॉर अचीविंग द ऑब्जेक्टिव
रामसर. हाँ रजत आई अंडरस्टैंड दैट रामसर इज अ मस्ट. देयर इज नो वे आउट. इट शुड बी इंप्लीमेंटेड. बट एज ए टीचर नाउ द क्वेश्चन इज आई एम आंसरिंग. Is it okay?
No problem, sir. Please go ahead.
So, as a teacher, that means at what level you are working? At the secondary or primary or elementary? At the secondary, because this is related to secondary. If you are working at the secondary level, you can give your expertise to develop module for the training of the teachers. More important is the teachers will do the best job in the implementation of Ramsar. So you can you should be trained properly, you should give your best effort, you should be sincere. This is one. Second is you must know the context where it is not working. Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha has many objectives. For example 100% retention of the students of class 9 and 10. Is it happening everywhere? If it is not happening, why not it is happening? What is the area? What is the socio-economic background? Now you can take up a project, action research. So therefore, the teacher should be acquainted with the concept of action research. What actions could be taken so that it is possible to bring those students to the line, to the mainstream? This is one. Most important is we can have a plan, action plan. We should have a plan. Which areas of Ramsar could be attended in a phased manner? All things could not be done haphazardly. If it is done, it will be haphazard manner. All things will not take place in every day, every year. So you must do in this year what will be taken care of. In next year, what will be taken care of in a phased manner? You can do so that as a teacher, you must, because you have no administrative authority. We have mostly academic authority. We are academic men. Academically, what we can do in that way, you can show your expertise and you can suggest better. You can make a documentation. Then it should be sent to your appropriate authority for taking care of it.
Then next, what is the obligation of teacher towards community in the present socio-economic scenario?
Gopal, what is the obligation of teacher towards community in the present socio-economic scenario of India? The present socio-economic scenario, you know that every moment the scenario is changing. We are in a changing context. That means we are in a state of flux, as the fragment say. We are in a state of flux. Now, if we are changing, then the teacher is obliged to make the people aware of the changes. In which direction the change is going on? Are the changes constructive or destructive? Now the students should be made aware of it. This is your obligation to tell to the community members, also to students. Similarly, awareness program can be generated. Then you can make a pilot study. Why it is happening? What kind of changes are there? How can we develop the socio-economic situation of the country? For example, if the situation in a particular country, in a particular context is, it is context specific. In the context, if the people are socio-economically poor, now what income generation activities could be taken up there in that locality so that they can accommodate themselves in the context, and that they will feel that we are also happy members of the society. Therefore, the role of the teacher is not very simple. The teacher has to be well versed with the situation, so that the community members can believe, can take these teachers into confidence that yes, this teacher what is saying, it is good for our hours.
Next is.
Sir, there is a question by Simantini Mishra.
What the difference?
She is asking about code of conduct and professional ethics. What is the difference between code of conduct and professional ethics?
Code of conduct is a part of professional ethics. For example, if you have accepted the profession like teaching, what is the ethics? The ethics says that we should have amicable behavior, amicable relationship with my students. Now, professional, your conduct is when you are dealing with this child, you should be impartial. You should not say something, you should not use any word which will hurt his mind. That means your conduct should lead to professional ethics. And the professional, that will lead to professionalism. Because you belong to a profession, and that profession has some abiding rules, regulations, moral values, that is being guided by you. That is your conduct. That conduct will help you for facilitating.
Binay Mishra is asking about the objectives of professional development. With what objective professional development should take place?
Now, it is accepted and agreed that we are all teachers. As teachers, we need to be professionally competent. For example, as I have given you an example, in my time, in mathematics, your concept of Vedic mathematics was not there. Now, when the student who has not been taught as Vedic mathematics, now he has been appointed as a teacher of mathematics. Can you say to a student, no, I have not been taught Vedic mathematics, I will not teach you. Therefore, how can you feel confident? Then you are going for attending your refresher class or orientation classes, something like that, so that you can feel confident. This is one. That is your in-service training. Through in-service training, you can up to date your before and making entry into the profession. Every profession demands some competency. For example, understanding students, your BEd program either through IGNO or through formal situation. We have the agreed upon framework being decided by the experts of NCT, National Council of Teacher Education. For example, in my time, we call it, even in your regional director, in our time, we call it education psychology. Now that the terminology has gone, we call it childhood and growing up. Now child is more important. Now how can the child grow? That is more important. The concept, thinking is there, intelligence is there, creativity is there. But it is our concern is child. In order to understand the child in a better manner, the specific attention is on child, not education psychology. We need not understand the psychology of the industrialist. We need not understand the psychology of the farmers. Our concern is child. Child is our center of education, child-centered education, child-centered curriculum. So therefore, before making entry into the profession, unless you have decided I will be a teacher, because yesterday I have told you, every teacher has a teacher behind. If you are a teacher, if I am a teacher, not necessarily that my father was a teacher. That man may be your brother, that man may be your mother, that man may be your uneducated father. That means inspiring. That man has inspired you to become a teacher. Therefore, before making entry to the field of teaching as a profession, you must be mentally prepared that I must do justice to my profession. I must, this is the objective. I must love my job. I must love my profession. I must be committed. Those commitment, those all the things will be developed. I tried to be developed through this pre-service program, pre-service, in-service. Sometimes orient. Your orientation course at the center or study center not. Why? Let the learners know the system of teacher training. What are the expectations? Or we call it what are the do's and do nots. Do's and do nots. So therefore, those will be your guideline. then the objective of your objective of professional development is to make you competent, to make you adjust to the professional situation, which is based upon in the changing situation of the society.
Sir, there is another question by Devi Prasad.
No.
He is asking about constructivism.
No.
And again, he is asking how constructivism can be implemented in teaching process.
Already it is implemented. All right, let me begin with the concept of constructivism. Constructivism. The naturalism seems like construct means the basic assumption of this thought is how do the students construct their knowledge. As you have told already, we have much has been talked. No students are alike. No two students are alike. You are intelligent, I am dull. But you are constructing, I am constructing. For example, the students have been given by the English teacher make a sentence by using that word mother. As I am telling you, if you are a very intelligent student, you can say my mother is unlike other mothers. My mother is unlike other mothers. But I am a dull student. I cannot understand it. I can say I have only a mother. Somebody will say I have many mothers. That means does it mean that the child who said I have many mothers, does it mean that his father has many wives? No, it is symbolic. The child, the learner who said I have many mothers means symbolically he treats all the women as mothers. India is my mother. I love my motherland. Does see how knowledge is constructed? That means it is a flexible approach. That the teacher must allow the child to explore his mind, to go beyond the text. If mother is used in a particular context, you take him, allow him to go on exploring, expand, elaborate. So therefore, the main concern of constructivism is to allow the student to think in a variety of way, not in a particular way. Already I have told you, we have two kinds of thinking. One is your divergent thinking and is convergent thinking. That divergent thinking is the base of constructivism. Let the student be allowed to construct in a knowledge in a different way. As I was telling you, Virat Kohli and before the marriage of Virat Kohli with Anushka, Virat and Kohli, now that they call Virushka. Viru, Virat, Viru, Anushka, now one word Virushka. India go indigo. Now for this purpose, this is not within 1 minute. It will take the mind some time to combine. So therefore, Toran say it is remote association. Remote, it will take time, distant time to associate. It is work of mind. So therefore, that divergent thinking is more important than convergent thinking. And this constructivism gives emphasis on that. Therefore, as a teacher, as I have said, in the classroom situation, you should not be very routine teacher. You should allow the teacher, such students, to go on thinking. And you can say, there is no right answer, there is no correct answer. There is no correct answer, there is no incorrect answer. For example, it will say, what is the question pattern? What is the name of first prime minister of independent India? The answer is Jawaharlal Nehru. If I say, reformulate the question, who was the first prime minister of independent India? The natural question is different. What is the name of the first prime minister of India? The name is Jawaharlal Nehru. You cannot say something else. Then that is wrong. Now this same question is different. The same thing, but the question is different. Who was the first prime minister of independent India? I can say Indira Gandhi, Mrs. Indira Gandhi's father. You can say Jawaharlal Nehru's husband. You can say Motilal Nehru's son. Like that, many answers. That is what your constructivist say. My point is, as a teacher, you should create a situation. We call it classroom environment, learning corner. Of course, that is friendly, learner friendly, where there is no fear. So that as a teacher, you should create a condition which is conducive to allow the students of your class to go beyond the text, to go beyond the reach of the thinking, and they can do this. Therefore, going beyond it.
There is another question by Satya Bhushan. Satya Bhushan sir is asking about systemic reforms, of course with respect to education. What is the meaning of systemic reforms?
This is in collaboration with your, or this is the corollary of your qualitative secondary education. We are talking about Rashtriya Madhyamika Shikha Abhiyan, that means universal secondary education. When we talk about universal secondary education, means all the students of class 9 and class 10, they should be given free and compulsory education. But that doesn't mean that in any form, in any way, quality cannot be compromised. Qualitatively, that secondary education should be visible. So their quality should be sensed. If that is to be sensed, then reform should be in the system of secondary education, not whole education. We must confine. If our target is qualitative secondary education for the purpose of education for all secondary school children, then what are the systemic reform? For example, one of the indicate parameters of the system is teacher. Let us think. Teacher program, teacher training program, teacher professional development, teacher development of teacher proficiency, teacher curriculum system, like that. So this is one system. For example, when you are talking about the reforming the system of teacher curriculum, then you can think of what should be the weightage of theory and practical. How many days should be there in the curricular transaction? For example, nowadays 200 days. 200 days have been earmarked. What kind of internship activities be included? What are the expectations of the internee or teacher trainee during the internship? In my time or in your audit time, teaching means going to school and make a deliver 20 lessons or something like that. Nowadays, only delivery of a lesson is not important. Also, you are going to school for something else. You are going and attending prayer class, we call it morning prayer, and preparing a report. You are conducting action research project. You are doing a project work. Because we call it school-based activity, not only teaching. Therefore, this is a stipulation. It is a kind of reform in the system of secondary education. See? Teacher, similarly, curriculum, similarly, teaching style, teaching method. Now, we have, for example, we have different on the basis of constructive vision, we have our 5E model or icon model. So this is also we have accepted. Similarly, system, if secondary education is to be universalized, then what reform should be there for the remote areas, for the disabled children, we are using differently abled. For the differently abled children, what kind of things we can do? Similarly, what are the infrastructures of the school which is going to give secondary education infrastructure? So these are some of the ways through which we can reform so that the system of secondary education could be qualitative.
Sir Ashok Das is asking what is the difference between colonial and imperial?
Colonial means yesterday, it was related to yesterday, all right. Colonial means British, East India Company. East India Company came to India and in the name of Christianity started education. To spread Christianity, that was the motto. Anyhow, then started trading. So that is under them, what kind of education came? That is your colonial. Another is your?
Imperial.
Imperial means for your understanding, empire. Who was ruling the India? The empire was British, or we call it British rulers or Britishers. Education during British rulers, education during East India Company. East India Company was a part of your British government. So after East India Company, when East India Company could not do well, so education was under the imperiality, that is British rule. This is the difference.
Sir, Monisa is asking about PPP, public-private partnership in education.
public private partnership. Now the question is, now education is a question of matter of collaboration. Education is not a question of government job. Gone are the days when we think, oh, this will be done by government. This road will be done by government. Education will be, this building will be done by government. Now, time is changed. It is because of globalization. The whole world is changing. We are bringing new, this concept is from America, from British foreign component, concept. So therefore, public-private partnership is a must. What? When the government has, the country is committed to universalize secondary education, much fund is required. We cannot afford, government cannot afford. Therefore, the alternative arrangement is public-private partnership. Like, for example, AJMI, for example, Birla, some NGOs or some companies, they have been not at the cost of quality. They have been given the guideline that you can take up this in the field of education. For example, you can give salary, you can accept, you can adopt a particular education in a particular area, you can give salary for the teacher, or you can give manpower to that institution, or you can take the responsibility of admission of the students. So sometimes the public sector, they can help you in the organization workshop, in the organization of your seminar, they can provide fund. Now, what you can do, not every part of secondary education, which is to be universalized and requires much fund, that can be met from the public sector, like companies. So therefore, we have to plan out, we have to earmark which area without compromising quality. Sometimes people say, if it is given to them, then there will be no quality. No, you must have a guideline. For example, fee structure. You can take up this responsibility in education. You can take the management side. But the teacher should be given the scale as prescribed by UGC. You can give promotion as prescribed by Government of India from time to time. If agreed, if there is a MOU, memorandum of understanding, then that public party, public agency will be given, either a management side or your student side or your organizing seminar side. That is what we call public-private partnership. Collaboration, private and public, they are combining together. It is a combination of both. So that the work will be easy, it will be convenient, and it will not be very tasking. So therefore, it is a must nowadays in the global world.
Sir, I think we have touched almost all the questions which were there in the chat box, and now it is 12:23. And you must also must be feeling exhausted. And ask
hello.
Ask hello. Yes, please. Do you want to ask?
Yes. Sir, sorry to interrupt you, sir. I'm Gyanaranjan, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I had a question in the chat box, but I think unfortunately I haven't picked up. That's why I switched on my microphone.
Please tell.
Ask your question.
So my question is, very earlier you told that we should follow equality as well as in case of differently abled child. So sir, actually there is a term that is integral education. In that education, we have to put the differently abled child with the normal child in a normal classroom. But
that is not integral, that is inclusive education.
Inclusive education. In the view of current scenario, there is no sufficient resource teacher in government school. So that is it okay to put that student, that suppose a blind student, in a normal classroom?
Therefore, we are going for public-private partnership, PP mode. That PP mode can help you. Of course, a problem could not be solved 100%. But now we are thinking of alternative. If resource teachers are not, we call it itinerant teacher. If such teachers are not evidently available, we can think of alternative, and the one of the alternative is your PP mode.
Sir, actually, I would like to add to this particular question, add to your particular answer. You see, Gyano, you must be knowing that there is a commission in the central level that is, physically handicapped commission. That commission is providing lot of funds to physically challenged students. For example, they are giving laptops, they are giving financial assistance, they are giving also financial assistance to procure the software for the blind, and many other things. And those are the things which are the supplementary materials which are really beneficial for the learners, those who are reading along with the normal students in the normal classroom situation. Therefore, the concept of inclusive education is a different kind of education with which all the learners can be benefited with the same kind of classroom situation. And there is complete description about all that in your study material also. If you can go through your study material, you can understand in a much better way. And Sir has also clearly explained about the inclusiveness of our education system. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Sir, should we conclude or would you like to say something on this particular occasion, because today is the last class, of course, for this course this is the last class, so you shall be taking one of the method paper also, because students are requesting me personally to learn from you on some other subjects, so if you agree, we will give you few more papers so that it will be better. I'll tell you later, sir. I will tell you as per your suitability. We'll fix up the date and time, and accordingly we'll inform the students also.
Please keep in mind that Sunday should not be included, because I have problem.
I know, sir. I know that you don't speak on Sunday, so that is all right for us, sir. With this,
Let me speak few words to the students.
Okay, sir. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please come on. Yes, sir. You are very much audible. You are very much audible, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
My dear students. Today is my last session. I am thankful to my student cum regional director Dr. Tripathi, who has invited me to take few sessions on the BS 122, and I am thankful to him that he has put on me confidence that I can do my job effectively, and I have tried my best. I do not know anyhow, my dear student, for you. Today or tomorrow, as Swami Vivekananda said, today or tomorrow we will die. If death is perennial, why should we die like a dog and like an animal? Do something for the country, do something for our students, for the profession, for the teaching community. And life has full of problems. We should go beyond the problems. We should come out of the problems and think of our profession. After your BEd, don't feel that I have completed my BEd, my work is over. You can do MEd, you can do MA education, feel professionally competent, because day by day new things are coming. So if you feel competent, if you don't feel competent, you cannot do the job to a student. And I have all my appreciation to you. I pray God sincerely that you should not only be successful in your exam, tournament examination conducted by you should also be successful in a life examination, in a life situation. Be a good man, do something good, and feel that you are a good man in the society and you have done something for the good of the society. Thank you very much, and hope that you will do good for the society.
Sir, thank you very much for such a nice presentation. All the presentations have been excellent, and we have got positive feedback from all the learners. Learners have been immensely benefited, and you have also relentlessly spoken.